بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد We begin this evening seeking the aid and the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, reading from a very famous work of a great scholar from the ulama of al-hadith, from the ulama of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah, the great Imam al-Hafidh Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi rahimahullahu ta'ala. He died in the year 600 after the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He has many works and efforts in spreading the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, a great scholar in hadith. From the most famous and well known of those works to the ulama and to the people of knowledge and to the students of knowledge, this work here that we will begin reading from, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, umdat al-ahkam, umdatul ahkam. This is a work the author, he has gathered narrations that are considered muttafaqun alayha, al-hadith al-muttafaq alayha, the narrations that both al-Imam al-Bukhari and al-Imam Muslim rahimahum Allahu ta'ala have narrated them and their authentic collections. He has gathered these narrations that are authenticated and narrated in the books of Bukhari and Muslim, fi sahihain. So the narrations in this particular work, they're all authentic. They're all authentic, rather they're all muttafaqun alayhi. So that means that they will be of the highest grade of authenticity. This is one of the mizas or the virtues or distinguishing points of this work. Likewise, it's concise. And the ulama, they have advised the students of knowledge, those who begin seeking knowledge, from the first books of hadith that they will memorize after the 40 hadith of An-Nawawi, they advise to memorize this work here. There is around 500 or more hadith approximately in this collection. And this is a hadith, or this is a collection, a hadith with regards to fiqh al-ibadat wa al-mu'amalat, with regards to the proper understanding of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with regards to acts of worship, and also with regards to dealings and transactions, also with regards to al-nikah wa-talaq, marriage and divorce, also with regards to al-jinayat, crimes and qisas, legal punishments. So this is a book that it collects the narrations in this manner, one chapter after another, one chapter after the next, beginning in the manner that the ulama have pretty much agreed upon in the way that they author these works, of course, beginning with that which is most important, al-ibadat. And from the most important acts of worship, the salat. And the key for salat is at-tahara. So we'll find that they begin with the chapter of Tahara in this manner. And then they move on to the rest of the pillars of Islam. As-Salat, wa-Zakat, wa-Sawm, wa-Hajj. And then moving on to Al-Buyur, the transactions wa-Mu'amalat. And after that, Al-Nikah wa-Talaq. And then after that, Al-Jinayat, wa-Qisas, wa-Hudud. In this manner, like this, is the tartib of the ulama, the fuqaha, whenever they write these books and these chapters of fiqh in this manner, beginning with that which is most important, the reason why the people were created, beginning with al-ibadat, and moving on next to al-mu'amalat, and so on and so forth. So this is a book that is discussing the issues of fiqh, fiqh al-ibadat wal-mu'amalat, not the issues of creed and belief. This particular work is focused on the issue of clarifying the means to worship Allah Azza wa Jalla and the rulings that are pertained therein, that which is permissible and that which is impermissible. And likewise in the dealings, in the dunya, in the affairs, and in the contracts with the people. This work clarifies these issues here. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned, and we all know the hadith, it's authentic. Likewise, muttafaqun alayhi. Man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihhu fid din. That whoever Allah wants good for, He'll give him understanding in the religion. So the greatest understanding is the understanding of the proper creed and the proper belief. Al-aqidah, what iman, what tawheed. And this is discussed in the works like we have been studying in the works of Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, Kitab al-Tawheed, Al-Qawa'id al-Arba', Usul al-Thalatha, so on and so forth, books of creed, Al-Wasitiyah, Al-Aqidah, Al-Wasitiyah, Al-Tahawiyah, so on and so forth, books of creed and belief, books of iman, clarifying the proper belief in the creed, which is the greatest fiqh and understanding. And based upon that, then the actions can be good. But after learning the proper creed, likewise, a person, he has to learn how to move. He has to learn how to worship, how to perform the actions properly. So the deen, it consists of actions that are inside the heart, inward actions. This is the creed and the aqidah, and iman, and tawheed. And likewise, it consists of outward actions, actions on the body parts, how to worship Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is also fiqh in the deen. So just as there's a condition, an inward condition for the actions to be accepted, and this is ikhlas and tawheed and the proper creed and belief to be done sincerely for the sake of Allah, which is studied in the books and taught from the books of al-aqidah, these issues of iman, ikhlas, and so on and so forth. Likewise, the deed also must be in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These issues are discussed in the books like this, Umdatul Ahkam, also similar to that, after this book, a larger book, the book of Ibn Hajar, rahimahullah ta'ala, the name of the book, Bulugh al-Maram, Bulugh al-Maram, which is a much greater book or bigger in size, containing more narrations, some of them are not authentic, so on and so forth. So a believer, he will begin with this book, Umdatu al-Ahkam. Before we begin reading the book, I find it to be very beneficial to learn something about this author, to know something about him. The author of Umdat al-Ahkam, his name is al-Shaykh or Imam al-Muhaddith Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi rahimahullah ta'ala. He was a great scholar of hadith. We have ulama of the sunnah who have shown great concern and care in collecting the biographies and the information of the scholars of the salaf and the ulama of al-Islam. And they have written great works collecting the information with regards to the life of the ulama, when they were born, what they did in their life, the events or the things that they have achieved, narrations that they have narrated, things that have occurred, all the way into their deaths. And this has all been collected by many of the ulama. They have works like this, collecting the biography, Tarajim al-Ulama. Very beneficial to read about them, to read about the Salaf, to read about the scholars, and to see their lives, and to take a lesson from their lives, and the way that they dedicated themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, serving His religion and deen, spreading and striving hard to spread the sunnah, striving hard to spread the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From those imams, scholars of hadith, who have given great concern with collecting the biographies, Al-Hafidh al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah ta'ala, al-Dhahabi, from the students of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, he died in the year 748. He has many works from them. This one that we will read or take some benefits from this evening, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, Siyar A'lam al-Nubala, the biographies of the noble and upright scholars. The biographies, Siyar A'lam al-Nubala, the great scholars, the biographies of the great scholars. This particular work is over 30 some odd volumes. It's a huge work that the author has collected, the biographies of many of the ulama from the time even from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the companions radiyallahu anhum until his time. And the scholars, the people of hadith, all the way to the companions. Here we have the 21st volume. Far into the work, he has mentioned the biography of this imam, the author of Umdat al-Ahkam. What's his name? Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. Al-Maqdisi. Al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah ta'ala. We'll read just a summarization, because the author here, Al-Dhahabi, he has written more than 10 pages with regards to him. And I was going to summarize some short benefits, but after reading through this, I found so many benefits in this, in his biography, and that it was hard to not to pass up each one of them. Rather, we'll just read what we can, and because there are so many lessons in the life of this imam. Lessons on how to live, how to be sincere and strive. Lessons of taking advantage of one's time, taking life seriously and striving hard in the path of Allah Azza wa Jal. So Al-Dhahabi, he mentioned in this tarjama, he says, Al-Imam al-Alim, first Abdul Ghani, mentioning him, Abdul Ghani rahimahullah, Al-Imam al-Alim al-Hafidh al-Kabir, Al-Imam al-Alim al-Hafidh al-Kabir, the great Imam and scholar, Al-Hafidh, someone who memorized many narrations. Along with those narrations, he memorized many names of the narrators. He knows more of the narrations than he is unaware of. The more narrators than he has forgotten or he is unaware of. His knowledge of hadith is greater than what he is unaware of from the hadith. The majority of the hadith, he knows them all. Al-Hafidh. The majority of the narrators of hadith and the chains of hadith, he knows them all. Naam, what he knows is more than what he does not know. From the collection of hadith and the sciences of hadith. Al-Hafidh al-Kabir, al-Sadiq al-Qudwa, the truthful, the role model, al-Abid al-Athari, al-Abid al-Athari. He is a devout worshipper and athari, sahib al-Athar, somebody who follows the narrations, somebody who is known for following the narrations, al-Muttaba', someone who himself he has followed. Rahim Allah ta'ala, al-Hafidh, he says, Adim al-Hufaz, Taqiyuddin, the scholar of the memorizers of hadith, Taqiyuddin Abu Muhammad Abdul Ghani Ibn Abdul Wahid. He mentioned to the end of his lineage, a long lineage that he mentioned here. We memorize the first name and his father's name and his kunya, Abu Muhammad Abdul Ghani Ibn Abdul Wahid Al-Maqdisi Al-Jama'iri Thumma Al-Damashqi Al-Mansha Al-Salihi Al-Hanbali. He's from the Hanbali scholars. He was born and raised in Damascus. Damascus is Damascus. Where is that? Huh? Naam. So this is where he's from, in this area, Al-Maqdisi, ascription to Al-Quds. Naam. So he says, mentioning about himself, Al-Dhahabi now, he says that there's another great scholar who lived in the same time, also is related in some way to the author, Abdul Ghani, Al-Hafidh Abdul Ghani rahimahullah ta'ala. His name is Ziyaddin Al-Maqdisi, also another scholar of hadith. Ziyaddin Al-Maqdisi. He died in the year 643. He has a great book of work called Al-Hadith Al-Mukhtara. Al-Hadith Al-Mukhtara. Selecting also narrations that are authentic on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Well-known scholar of hadith. Al-Dhahabi, he mentioned he read the biography of Al-Hafidh al-Bughani from the work of Ziyaddin. So he's transmitting from here. The work he's transmitting here from Ziyaddin al-Maqdisi. He says, وُلِدَ سَنَةِ إِحْدَى وَأَرْبَعِينَ وَخَمْسَمِيَّةِ بِجِمَاعِيلِ أَذُنُّهُ فِي رَبِيعِ الْآخِرِ قَالَتْ وَالِدَتِي هُوَ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ أَخِيهَا الشَّيْخَ الْمُوَفَّقِ بِأَرْبَةِ أَشْهُرِ وَالْمُوَفَّقُ وُلِدَ فِي شَعْبَانِ. Ziyaddin, he says, rahimahullah, that he was born, that Abdul Ghani, he was born in the year 541 in a place called Jama'il. And he said, I think it was in Rabi'. His mother told him that he is older than her brother. Her brother is another great scholar. The mother of Ziyaddin, her brother is another great scholar. His name is Muwaffaq al-Din, Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi. He is the author of Numat al-Itiqad. And he's the author of Al-Mughni, Wal-Kafi, Wal-Muqni', Wa-Umdat al-Fiqh. A great scholar also of the Hanbali scholars. And he is actually the cousin of Al-Hafidh al-Ghani. They're cousins. They're born in the same year. Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi and Abdul Ghani al-Maqdisi. Abdul Ghani al-Maqdisi, he is the author of Umdat al-Ahkam. Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, he is the author of Lum'atu al-Itiqad and also Al-Mughni, the great book of fiqh. A great book of fiqh. Two great scholars, they're born in the same year and they're cousins. Coming from a family of knowledge. Coming from a family of knowledge. Naam, they study together. They travel together. They seek knowledge together. And his cousin, they're born in the same year. One and the other one is just a few months older. It's just a few months older. So he mentions here, he said about, this is a summarization here, Dhahabi, he mentioned about the author, Al-Hafidh al-Bughani. He said, وَلَمْ يَزَلْ يَطْرُبُ وَيَسْمَعُ وَيَكْتُبُ وَيَسْحَرُ وَيَدْأَبُ وَيَأْمُرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَيَتَقِيَ اللَّهَ وَتَعَبَّدَ وَيَسُومَ وَيَجْتَهِدْ وَيَنْشُرَ الْعِلْمَ إِلَىٰ أَنْ مَهْدْ. He said that this individual here, Al-Hafidh al-Bughani al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said he continued to seek knowledge and to listen to narrations and to write hadith and to stay up at nighttime in worship and to go upon this way and to command the good and to prohibit the evil. He continued to fear Allah Azza wa Jalla and to worship Allah alone. He continued to fast in the daytimes and stand in the night prayer and spread knowledge all the way until he died. All the way until he died. This is what is mentioned about him, rahimahullah ta'ala. He mentioned about his traveling and how did he obtain this knowledge. رَحَلَ إِلَى Baghdad مَرَّتَيْنِ. He traveled to Baghdad. He's from where? Dimashq. He traveled to Baghdad. This is where? And how? How did they travel? And he died in 600. He was born in 541. They're traveling two times to Baghdad. رَحِمَ ta'ala. And he says he went to Misr مَرَّتَيْنِ. He traveled to Egypt also. Two times. وَسَافَرَ إِلَى بَغْدَادِ هُوَ وَابْنُ خَالَتِهِ الشَّيْخ مُوَفَّقٍ فِي أَوَّلِ سَنَةِ إِحْدَى وَسِتِينَ وَخَمْسِمِيَةٍ. He traveled also to Egypt with his cousin in the beginning of the year of 561. How old were they? 561. They were born in 541. 20 years old, he's traveling. 20 years old, they're together traveling to seek knowledge, leaving Damascus and going to Egypt, traveling to seek knowledge. It mentioned that they would travel together and they would seek knowledge together before they even had hair on their faces. Before they barely had hair on their faces, they're going. One would go to the class, he would travel with him to the class. The other one would go to the dars, he would travel with him to the dars. Abdul Ghani, he had an inclination to hadith. And his cousin, Muwafiq al-Din, Ibn Qudama, rahimahumullah ta'ala, he had an inclination to fiqh. But both of them, they benefit from each other. Both of them, they benefit from each other. And they will seek knowledge together in this manner. Likewise, Al-Dhahabi, he has another book called Tathkiratu al-Huffaz. Tathkiratu al-Huffaz. He mentioned also a beautiful summarization about this imam, Abdul Ghani al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah ta'ala, in this other work likewise. He says, and he mentions from a man, Ibn Najjar, from the scholars of hadith, he says, حدث بالكثير. Abdul Ghani al-Maqdisi rahimahullah ta'ala, حدث بالكثير وصنف في الحديث تصانيف حسنة. He narrated much and he authored many great works in hadith. وكان غزير الحفظ من أهل الإتقان والتجويد. He had a very strong memorization and he was from the people of precision and preciseness. قيما بجميع فنون الحديث. He had well-grounded in every aspect, every science from the sciences of hadith. Al-Hafidh Abdul Ghani, he was well-grounded in every science from the sciences of hadith. And the fiqh of hadith, usul al-hadith, mustalah hadith, ilm al-rijal, al-ilal, all of these sciences is mentioned that he was precise and he was well-grounded and firm in all of these sciences from hadith. Then he mentioned here, describing the imam, he says, كَانَ كَثِيرُ الْعِبَادَةِ وَرِعًا مُتَمَسِكًا بِالسُّنَّةِ. He was a person that was known for a lot of worship. He was always in a state of worship, worshipping Allah Azza wa Jalla, and also he was known for piety and wara', كَانَ وَرِعًا. that he would leave off the doubtful affairs. Rahimahullah ta'ala, mutamassikan bis sunnah. He was somebody who was known for holding fast to the sunnah of the Prophet. Mutamassikan bis sunnati ala qawaneen as-salaf. That he would hold fast to the sunnah of the Prophet following the principles of the salaf. Following the principles of the salaf. He said, تَكَلَّمَ فِي الصِّفَاتِ وَالْقُرْآنِ بِشَيْءٍ أَنْكَرَهُ أَهْلُ التَّأْوِيلِ مِنَ الْفُقَهَاءِ وَشَنَّعُوا عَلَيْهِ. That he would speak in his classes, in his durus, he would speak about the sifat of Allah Azza wa Jalla in the proper manner. And also the proper creed in the Qur'an. And the people of misguidance, they disliked him a lot. They disliked him and they tried to refute him. And they even had made tahrish between him and the ruler. And they had set a gathering. He mentioned that they disliked him and his way. فَعُقِدَ لُهُ مَجْلِسٌ بِدَارِ السُّلْطَانِ بِدِمَشْقِ فَأَصَرْ. Those people, the other ulama, there were ulama in this time of misguidance. Many of the ulama were tried by ta'wilat and by the creed of the Jahmiyyah and the filthy creed of the Mu'tazila, so on and so forth, where they denied the sifat of Allah Azza wa Jalla and they rejected them and they reinterpreted them in a false manner. But the ulama of the sunnah, they were still alive, and the sunnah was still alive, but they were sometimes in some areas they were not strong. They did not have the authority, yani through the land. And sometimes in the history of Islam, the rulers would be influenced by the people of innovation, like in the time of Imam Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala. It was the case was here. So whenever he would, in his classes, it was mentioned that he would mention the narrations of the nuzul of Allah Azza wa Jalla and how he descends in a manner befitting His Majesty. And he would mention the narrations with regards to the sifat of Allah Azza wa Jalla, so on and so forth. And the scholars of falsehood and the evil scholars, they would refute him or try to refute him and try to cause much trouble for him. And they set a gathering for him to be in front of the leader and to have a munadara. And it's mentioned that he did not back down. It's mentioned that his nephew, Ibn Qudama, كان يداريهم. He made mudarat like with them. We know what mudarat is. He would be kind to them in order to avoid their harm. But Al-Hafidh Abdul-Ghani, he was not able to be patient. And rather he stood firm and he showed enmity towards them, even though he was alone. And they set this majlis for them to have in front of the ruler and in front of all of these ulama of kalam. And they tried him in this. And he stood firm and he mentioned his proofs and his points and the creed of the salaf. And they riled up the ruler upon him and they declared him to, they found it permissible to kill him. They found it permissible in abahu qatlahu. And this is what is mentioned here. And they said, abahu qatlahu. And then he says in his here, فَشَفَّعَ فِيهِ أُمَرَاءَ الْأَكْرَادِ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَبْرَحَ مِنْ دِمَشْقِ فَذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ مِصْرِ وَقَامَ بِهَا خَامِلًا إِلَىٰ حِينَ وَفَاتِهِ. And so he stood firm and he refuted those people of falsehood, and then they had declared him. And they find the one who, like this, they say that he, the one who affirms the attributes. They call him Mujassima, saying that Allah Azza wa Jalla, he has... claiming that he has parts like the human being and that he made tashbih because of their misguided understanding and their corrupt creed, and they declared it lawful to kill him. And then some of the Kurdish princes, they stepped in and they made intercession for him and allowed him to leave the land, like to be banished. And he left and went to Misr until he died. Rahimahullah ta'ala. This is a brief summarization of his life. How he was steadfast in ibadah, and how he used to command the good, and how he was known for piety and the proper creed, all the way until he was harmed in the path of Allah Azza wa Jal. All the way until he was harmed in the path of Allah Azza wa Jal. It was mentioned about him in his life. In his biography, it says, وَكَانَ رَحِيمَهُ اللَّهُ مُجْتَهِدًا عَلَى الطَّلَبِ يُكْرِمُ الطَّلَبَ وَيُحْسِنُ إِلَيْهِمْ وَإِذَا صَارَ عِنْدُهُ طَالِبٌ يَفْهَمُ أَمْرَهُ يفهم أمره بالرحلة ويفرح له أو يفرح لهم بسماع ما يحصلونه أو يحصلونه وبسببه سمع أصحابنا الكثير ضياء الدين المقدسي. He says that this Hafidh Abdul Ghani rahimahullah, he would strive to seek knowledge. كان مجتهدا على الطالب. He was striving to seek knowledge. Also, he would honor the students of knowledge and he would do good to them, giving them wealth and aiding them. And if there was a student that he had that would understand well and he was a good student, he would hurry up and encourage him to travel, go seek knowledge. This is the one that you understand good. He understands well. He has a strong memory. He has a strong understanding of the deen. He's clever. He would encourage him to go seek knowledge. We see that this is contrary to many of the people today. If they find a child that has a strong memory, or he's very swift and smart, they hurry up and send him to the disbelieving schools to learn medicine or to learn engineering and so on and so forth. And they find one that he is slow to understand, or he can't memorize well, or he's not very smart or bright, and I'll send him to the masjid, let him learn the Qur'an. Send him to the masjid, let him learn the Qur'an. As for the way of the Salaf al-Salih, if they found somebody from their children or from the students, from the people that were strong, and he was bright and swift, they would send him to seek knowledge. They would send him to seek knowledge, and they would aid him and support him, and he providing for him and encouraging him. He said, because of this, because of Al-Hafidh Abdul Ghani, many of our companions, they benefited and they learned. It's mentioned also here in the same portion that he would send his children and he would send other people's children to go seek knowledge. He would pay for them. He would pay for them and he would send them. يُرَحِلُونَهُمْ يُرَحِلُهُمْ وَيُسَفِّرُهُمْ. He would send them on rihla. He would send them to go seek knowledge. He would send them to the people. It's even mentioned he at one time he sent a group of them and he sent them with Sahih Bukhari. And he sent them with Al-Mu'jam al-Kabir al-Tabarani. And he sent them also a book of seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He sent a group of them, young men, to go to Egypt to study. He sent with them. To Asbahan, to Asbahan. And he was sent them with these books and with a note to the imam there and to the scholar of hadith there, and he verifying them and saying to take care of them. And says, I'm sending them to you to learn like this. And he would have the books for them and he would provide for them to leave and to go seek knowledge. And this is from the affair of this imam, that he was concerned with knowledge, not only himself, but also in others. And if he found somebody that was strong and able to learn, he would send them and encourage them to go, encourage them to learn. His gatherings, of knowledge. It's mentioned in his gatherings that he would narrate hadith. And sometimes he would narrate hadith and he would cry, the people would cry. It's mentioned that somebody would attend his gathering one time. After that, they'll never leave. After that, they will never leave. The first time after he attended one gathering, I will never leave this gathering. So much benefit. So much benefit. Like that, the gatherings of the ulama. Wallahi, if you attend the gatherings of the ulama one time, the first time, inshallah, I'll never leave this gathering. I'll never leave this gathering. Because you find the great light and the benefit that you find and how your life improves by sitting in the gatherings of the ulama. And how Allah brings much light and goodness to you from their gatherings. And this was the example of his gatherings, that he was like this. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Even it's been mentioned that what was said to him after one person met in his gathering, he said to him, Wallahi laqad hamat al-Islam. He said, verily you're carrying Islam. And he sees how much benefit. It's as if you're carrying Islam on your back, you, yourself. And the good that he has, and the khair that he has, and that he's bringing to the people. It's mentioned also from his cousin. Who's his cousin? Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi. He mentioned about his cousin, Abdul Ghani. He said about him, كان الحافظ Abdul Ghani جامعاً للعلم والعمل. He was a person who gathered between knowledge and action. That's what they said about him. That's what his cousin said about him. Also a great scholar of hadith and fiqh. That he was a person who gathered between knowledge and action. وَكَانَ رَفِيقِي فِي السِّبَةِ. And he was my companion, traveling with me whenever we were young, to seek knowledge. فِي طَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ. And seeking knowledge. وَمَا كُنَّا نَسْتَبِقُ إِلَى خَيْرٍ إِلَّا سَبَقَنِي إِلَيْهِ إِلَّا الْقَلِيلِ. And we would never hasten or strive to compete to do good, except he would always beat me, except for a few times. And this is the case. And his cousin is saying about his cousin. And the two students of knowledge striving in the path of Allah Azza wa Jalla. This one we would hasten and strive to do good. We would compete with each other. As for him, he would always beat me. I only beat him a few times in achieving the good. And this is the example here we have of this great imam. So from that we see that the believers, they compete in good. They compete in good. They compete in good. At the same time, they're humble. If their brother has more good than them, they say Alhamdulillah. But they strive behind him. They follow his way. Doesn't always have the person be, he's the one who's in the leader. He's the one who's in the chair. He's the one that people are pointing at. Nah, you just go along on the path. And you compete with your brothers. And you in goodness. You compete with them in goodness and you strive. And to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, وَكَمَّلَ اللَّهُ فَضِيلَتَهُ بِابْتِلَائِهِ بِأَذَى أَهْلِ الْبِدْعِ وَعَدَاوَتِهِمْ. And Allah Azza wa Jal, He completed His virtue by trying Him with the harm of the people of innovation. As we've seen before previously in a summarization, He was harmed by the people of innovation. Even they tried to kill Him and He was banished, rahimahullah ta'ala, by the people of innovation because of his strong stance on the sunnah and His proper creed. Naam rahimahullah ta'ala, He says, وَرِزْقُ الْعِلْمِ وَتَحْسِينُ الْكُتُبِ الْكَثِيرَةِ وَرُزِقَ الْعِلْمُ وَتَحْسِينُ الْكُتُبِ الْكَثِيرَةِ إِلَّا أَنْهُ لَمْ يُعَمَّرُ. It's mentioned that he had much knowledge, and also he obtained many books and knowledge and understanding, except he did not live long. It's mentioned here likewise from his own brother. His own brother, Shaykh al-Imad. He says, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَشَدَّ مُحَافَظَةً عَلَى وَقْتِهِ مِنْ أَخِي. I never seen anybody more stern upon preserving and protecting his time than my brother. We see, how did this man get at this status and this rank? He's somebody who knows the virtue of time. He's not somebody who's wasting his time. He's not somebody who says, I have some time to kill, and I have some time to waste. Wasting his time looking at this and that, at things that are not beneficial. Rather, he's somebody who took advantage of his time, and because of this, Allah Azza wa Jalla put barakah kathira in his efforts, and he became the imam that he is. And now his book is with us today, memorized by thousands and hundreds of thousands, until this day, memorizing Umdat al-Ahkam, memorizing his work, mentioning his name, rahimahullah ta'ala, because of his sternness upon the sunnah, and likewise because of the way that he preserved his time. This is from the way of the people of the sunnah, that they are people who know the value of time. Naam, it's mentioned about him in his time, كان الحافظ عبد الغني نازلاً عندي بأسبحان. One of the people mentioned, he was a tajir. He said, when he would come to Asbahan, he would stay with me. He's telling us about it. Whenever he would stay with him, what did he do? He said, وَكَانَ يَنَامُ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ وَمَا كَانَ يَنَامُ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. He barely slept at nighttime. بَلْ يُصَلِّي وَيَقْرَأُ وَيَبْكِي. Rather, he barely slept at nighttime. Rather, he would pray and recite and cry. This man, he would come and visit and he would stay here, and then this is how he lived. He's mentioning how he lived whenever he's visiting there. He didn't sleep at nighttime except for a little bit. Rather, he stood in the night prayer and he recited the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla and cry. And this is rujula, manhood, piety and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, standing in the night prayer when the people are asleep, whenever he's alone with his Lord, reading the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla, crying out of fear of his sins, so on and so forth. These are great examples for a believer. We follow the Salaf al-Salih. These are our qudwa and our role models, not these people that we see today in YouTube and on the internet and on the TV and here in the streets, so on and so forth. But rather we take the people who have taken the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as their role model, we take them as our role model. Naam, we take them as our role model. Naam, it's been mentioned likewise, he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدٍ عَلَى سِيرَةِ الْحَافِظِ وَكَانَ مُشْتَغَلٍ طُولَ زَمَانِهِ. They mention about him, I never seen anybody on the methodology of this person. He was busy his whole life. And he's always busy doing something beneficial, and he's taking advantage of his time. It's mentioned about how in the beginning we've seen that he was, what he was described with, كَانَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَى الْمُنْكَرِ. That he was a person, he would command the good, and he would prohibit the evil, and he was known for this. Even in his stance against the innovators, he was not able to make mudarat. He was not able to be patient. He stood his position and he refuted them directly, even though he was alone. And so he was like this. He was not somebody, he couldn't see the evil going on, except he would have to prohibit it. It's been mentioned in his biography here, he said, كَانَ لَا يَرَى مُنْكَرًا إِلَّا غَيَرَهُ بِيَدِهِ أَوْ بِلِسَانِهِ. He said, he would not see some evil, except he would change it with his hand or his tongue. وَكَانَ لَا تَأْخُذُهُ فِي اللَّهِ لَوْمَةُ لَهِمْ. And he was never afraid of the blamers, for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, those who would blame him. He said about him, وَقَدْ رَأَيْتُهُ مَرَّةً يُهْرِيكُ خَمْرًا. I seen him one time pouring out some alcohol, somebody's wine. فَجَبَذَ صَاحِبُهُ وَالسَّيْفِ. The person, he said, I seen him one time pouring out somebody's wine, and that person went to grab his sword. And then what does he say about him? فَلَمْ يَخَفْ مِنْهُ. He was not even afraid of him. He poured out this man's alcohol. The man who got mad, he's going to grab his sword. And how was his stance? He said he was not even afraid of him. He was said, مَا فَلَمْ يَخَفْ مِنْهُ وَأَخَذَهُ مِنْ يَدِهِ وَكَانَ قَوِيًا فِي بَدَنِهِ. He said that he took the sword from that man. He was not afraid of him, and he took his sword out of his hand. Like this. He poured out his alcohol. He wanted to pull the sword on him. He took the sword out of his hand. He's not afraid of him. He's not afraid of him. He said he was also strong in his body. He was a big person. Many times in Damascus, and you would find him refuting the people and reprimanding them and prohibiting the evil until he would break the instruments and the flutes. The musical instruments and the flutes, he would see them, he would break them himself. He would break them himself. He would see them, he would break them. He would break them. And they're in the lands of the Muslims. He would break them. Yani, and he's a great scholar. Is Qala Khali al-Muwaffaq, he said, he mentioned here, Diyad-Din al-Maqdisi, he mentioned my uncle said, al-Muwaffaq, yani Ibn Qudama, كان الحافظ لا يصبر على أو عن إنكار المنكر إذا رآه. He said, al-Hafidh Abdul Ghani, he was not able to be patient. He couldn't hold himself to refute or to reprimand or prohibit the evil. If he saw evil, he had to reprimand it. He had to prohibit it. And he was not able to stop himself. And he had to stop it. He couldn't accept it like this. This is how he was. وَكُنَّا مَرَّةً أَنْكَرْنَا عَلَى قَوْمٍ وَأَرَقْنَا خَمْرَهُمْ فَتَضَارَبْنَا. Now he said that one time, he's talking about himself now. This is Ibn Qudama. He said, one time we had refuted some people. And we had prohibited their evil, and they are drinking alcohol. We poured out their alcohol. So what happened? They start fighting. He said, "فَسَمِيَ خَادِي أَبُو عُمَرَ فَضَاقَ صَدْرُهُ وَقَسَمْنَا فَلَمَّا جِئْنَا إلَى الْحَافِظِ طَيَّبَ قُلُوبَنَا وَصَوَّبَ فِعْلَنَا وَتَلَى وَأَنْهَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ." And this is what happened to the younger ones, to Ibn Qudama, him and his companions. They poured out these people's alcohol. You can't drink around here. Like, they poured out their alcohol, so then they got into a fight. After this, they told the Hafidh Abdul Ghani what happened. They told him what happened. You know, we poured out these people's alcohol and we reprimanded them, and then they start fighting us. He said, and so they felt bad. Maybe they did something wrong, and he made them feel better. He said, no. What you did is right. Everything is good. He said he calmed down. He gave them peace in their heart, and he recited to them the verse of Allah Azza wa Jalla: "Wanha an munkar wasbir ala ma asabak." Prohibit the evil and be patient about what afflicts you. Prohibit the evil. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he mentioned in his book, prohibit the evil. Prohibit the evil and be patient about what afflicts you. And this is the way that they used to be like this. They were strong in the Deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla. They didn't have any people sinning publicly like this. The people, they had ghira for the Deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. They would prohibit that. They wouldn't allow that. They wouldn't allow that. They would stop that. And if they could stop it with their hand and they had that ability, they do that. If not, then a believer, he refute it with the tongue. For us in these lands, we don't have that ability. And by the way, and in these lands, we don't have the ability to change it with our hands. So it wouldn't be from the sunnah for us in these lands, for example, to go breaking the people's alcohol. We don't have that ability here. We don't have that ability here. Now, we shouldn't misunderstand the narrations of the Salaf and misapply them. And here we can make inkar with the tongue and with the heart. As for with the hand, we don't have that. We don't have that ability. We don't have that ability. It's mentioned about him, Diyad-Din al-Maqdisi said about him, مَا أَعْرِفُ أَحَدًا مِنْ أَحْلِ السُّنَّةِ رَآهُ إِلَّا أَحَبَّهُ وَمَدَحَهُ كَثِيرًا وَمَدَحَهُ كَثِيرًا. I don't know anybody who's seen him. I don't know anybody who ever seen him or met him except he would love him and praise him a lot, and he from the people of the Sunnah. No one from the people of the Sunnah would see Al-Hafidh Abdul Ghani, rahimahullah ta'ala, except they would love him and praise him kathiran. Naam, this was the case of this great scholar. It's mentioned, كان الحافظ يصطف الناس في السوق ينظرون إليه ولو أقام بأسبحان مدة وأراد أن يملكها لملكها. And it's mentioned in Asbahan that if he would come out, the people would line up to see him. Oh, that's the great scholar. They would line up to see him. And he mentioned if he stayed there for long, then he wanted to be the king, they would make him the king. And they loved him. And for his piety, and for his righteousness, and for the goodness that he has. Likewise, it's been mentioned about him, rahimahullah ta'ala, that he was very, very, very generous. We've seen before that he would pay for the students to go seek knowledge. And he would send them, and pay for them to seek knowledge. Likewise, it's mentioned about him, لَقَدْ سَمِعَ عَنْهُ أَنُّهُ كَانَ يَخْرُجُ فِي اللَّيْلِ بِالْخِفَافِ الدَّقِيقِ إلى بيوت متنكرا في الظلمة فيعطيهم ولا يعرف وكان يفتح عليه بالثياب فيعطي الناس وثوبه مرقع. It's mentioned about him that he would go out at night time when it's dark and no one could see him, and he would go out and he would go to the poor people in the houses and he would give them food so that he wouldn't be known. It wouldn't be known. And this is sometimes he would go out at nighttime, whenever it's dark, and he would take with him food and supplies, and he would leave it for them. And he would leave it for them, and no one would know who has provided that for him. It's mentioned that people would come to him with their thobes out, with their garments out, so that he could fill it up. And his own garment would have patches and the likes would be worn out. And his own garment would be worn out. But he is giving. They have their garments out like this for him to fill it up for them. And he was very generous to the people. Likewise, it's mentioned about him that he would take care of the orphans. And also he would take care of the widows. Like particularly, he would spend money on them. And whenever he had wealth and he obtained money, he would spend it on the orphans, and he would check for the widows and the women who did not have any guardians to look over them, and he would provide for them. And he was this is the way of the people of the Sunnah. And he was a man taking care of the Muslims, not taking care of himself only and his family, taking care of the Muslims, looking after the children of the Muslims, looking after the orphans of the Muslims, looking after the widows of the Muslims and the poor and the needy of the Muslims. This is the high and lofty manners and conduct of this great Imam, rahimahullah ta'ala. It's mentioned about him, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدٍ أَكْرَمَ مِنْهُ يعني مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدٍ أَكْرَمَ. They never seen anybody more generous than him. And likewise, this is the way of the ulama. Many times I remember the ulama, I remember, subhanAllah, we traveled one time to visit Sheikh Zayd al-Madkhali, rahimahullah ta'ala. He lives in Samita. It's about 12 or 13 hours from Medina. So we have to save our money to go there, and save our money to get there, save our money to stay there. We stay there for like 2 or 3 weeks, like this. So me and a few of our friends, we save our money to go there and to stay there, and so that we have provision. After we get there, the Shaykh, wallahi, rahimahullah, he refused. He paid for the... Where are you staying? We're staying in a hotel. He refused. He forced to pay for the hotel. He forced to pay for the food. For the whole time, he paid for the food. He paid for the hotel. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Even before, when we're getting ready to leave, he called us all together. And he had his secretary call us all together and gave every one of us 300 and something riyals. We left that place with more money than we came with. We left Samita, we went to Samita to seek knowledge. And he gave us books, and he gave us very generous. Wallahi, he gave us, we left, I left there with more money than I came with. That's the first time I went. I went again, another time, even after he died, rahimahullah ta'ala, and his sons, may Allah reward them, Sheikh Ali particularly, Ibn Zayd, hafidhahullah ta'ala, I would go there, and they their neighbors, and they love students of knowledge. They are generous and they're kind to you. They provide you food. You'll be shy from them. They give you money, and you leave there with you. You have money to carry yourself, but what you wind up leaving with more money. Sheikh Abdul Muhsin, whenever he starts a new book, he'll buy, and his gathering is an ocean of gathering. Whenever he starts a new book, nobody buys a book. He provides books for everybody. When he starts Sahih Muslim, there's copies being passed out for Sahih Muslim for days. Sheikh Abdul Razak, if he starts a new book, he said the book is given free at this door. Go to this door in the masjid, you'll find the book for free. You go there and it's just passed out. They provide for it. They're generous. The ulama, they're generous. And they love the students of knowledge. They take advantage of this great virtue. This is from the way of the scholars and the people of hadith. And to support the people of knowledge and to support the students of knowledge. And to have a share in their effort. And to have a share in that good. Maybe if I can't go to seek, I will help him seek. Yeah, I'll make it easy for him to go to seek knowledge. Providing for him his way like this. Providing for his family, so on and so forth. Making it easy for him. And he's sharing in that great effort. Sharing in that great effort. This great Imam, rahimahullah ta'ala, he had a life like this. As we've seen in the beginning, he spent his whole life seeking knowledge and writing. And calling to Allah Azza wa Jalla, teaching until the enemies of Islam or the people of innovation, likewise, they threw him out of his land, rahimahullah ta'ala. It's mentioned about him likewise that he lost his eyesight almost. Why? From reading so much and from crying. Mentioned like from reading so much, he lost, and not completely, But he lost some of his eyesight, rahimahullah ta'ala, because of reading and writing. Reading and writing so much and crying. And those days they don't have lights in the houses. And there'll be at nighttime they have candles, or they have the lights like this, a torch, so on and so forth. But after so much reading and so much writing and also crying out of the fear of Allah Azza wa Jal, he mentioned that he lost his eyesight. And that in his time there was nobody like him. Even they mention about him that he never saw anybody like him. He himself never saw anybody yani like him. He was one of those great scholars and one of the people that are considered and Allah knows best, the awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal. From the awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal. From those who are close and near to Allah Azza wa Jal. So this is from his work and from his book that we will begin reading, inshaAllah. A great imam from the imams of hadith, Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah ta'ala. What's the author's name? Al-Hafiz Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah. When was he born? 541. Who is his cousin? Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah. When was he born? In the same year. Here we just mention one more time about his time. كَانَ لَا يُضَيِّعُ شَيْئًا مِنْ زَمَانِهِ بِلَا فَائِدَةً. He would never let anything from his time go without benefit. فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ يُصَلِّ الْفَجْرِ وَيُلَقِّنُ الْقُرْآنِ. He used to pray Fajr, and then after that, teach Qur'an. وَرُبَّمَا أَقْرَأَ شَيْئًا مِنَ الْحَدِيثِ تَلْقِينًا. So he wouldn't let any of his time go by without any benefit. How did he do that? He would pray Fajr, then he would sit and teach Qur'an. And then also maybe he would teach some hadith also, like this. And then he would stand and then he would pray and mention his day like this. This is his day. And this is the example of this man as somebody who was successful. He would spend his days like this. It's mentioned, and we try to finish, inshallah, about the biography of this great imam, his death. His son, he narrates to us his death, rahimahullah ta'ala. He said, and he's one of his sons, Abu Musa, he said, مَرِضَ أَبِي فِي رَبِيًّا الْأَوَّلِ مَرَضًا شَدِيدًا مَنَعَهُ مَنَ الْكَلَامِ وَالْقِيَامِ. He said, my father, he became very sick in Rabi' al-Awwal, and it prohibited him from speaking or even standing. وَشْتَدَّ سِدَّةَ عَشَرْ يَوْمًا. And it became very harsh for him for 16 days. وَكُنْتُ أَسْأَلُهُ كَثِيرًا. And I would always ask him, and his father, مَا تَشْتَهِي. What do you like? What do you desire? Do you need something? So he would say, فَيُكُولُ أَشْتَهِي الْجَنَّةِ. I just desire Jannah. أَشْتَهِي رَحْمَةَ اللَّهِ. He's sick. He can't even hardly speak. He says, "This is what would you do? You crave anything? Or you would you like anything? Can I get you anything?" He said, "I only want Jannah." He said, "Ashtahi, I want the mercy of Allah." And his son, he says, "La yizidu ala dhalik." He wouldn't say anything else. He doesn't want water. He doesn't want food. He doesn't want Allah. He said, "All I want is Jannah." He's sick and he's sick on a deathbed. All I want is the mercy of Allah. Now he says, "Fajituhu bima'in harin famadda yadahu fawadda'tuhu waqtal fajr." So he said, so I come to him with hot water and he would stick out his hands and I would make wudu for him at the time of Fajr. فَقَالَ يَا عَبْدَاللَّهِ قُمْ صَلِي بِنَا وَخَفِّفْ. He said, he would say, oh Abdullah, stand and pray with us and make it light. فَصَلَيْتُ بِالْجَمَاءَ وَصَلَّ جَالِسًا. So he said, I prayed with the congregation and he prayed sitting. ثُمَّ جَلَسْتُ عِنْدَ رَأْسِهِ. And then I sat at his head. فَقَالَ يَقْرَأْ يَاسِينَ. He said, read Yasin, chapter Yasin for me. So he said, فَقَرَأْتُهُ. I read it for him. وَجَعَلَ يَدْعُو وَأَنَا أُؤَمِّنْ. So he started making dua and I would say Ameen. And he's on his deathbed. He says here, فَقُلْتُ هُنَا دَوَاءٌ تَشْرَبُ. He said, here's some medicine, you can drink it. He said, يَا بُنَي مَا بَقِيَ إِلَّا الْمَوْتِ. He said, nothing is left for me except death. And this is a sickness that the medication can't cure. He said, oh my beloved son, nothing remains for me except for death. فَقُلْتُ مَا تَشْتَهِي شَيْئًا. He said, you don't want anything? He said, قَالَ أَشْتَهِي النَّظْرَ إِلَى وَجْهِ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ. He said, I only want to see the face of Allah the Most High. فَقُلْتُ مَا أَنْتَ عَنِّي رَاضٍ. He said, are you not pleased with me? He said, بَلَى وَاللَّهِ. He said, rather I'm very, he said, wallahi, I'm pleased with you. He said, مَا تُوصِي. And subhanAllah, look at that. His son is worried about him. His son is worried. مَا أَنْتَ رَاضٍ. You're not pleased with me. You don't, he said, can I get you something? Can I get you this? Can I get you that? And his father is sick. No, you can't. No, I don't, don't worry about it. Are you not happy with me? Are you not pleased with me? Are you mad at me? And his son is worried about that. And how many of us today are worried if our parents are mad at us? How many of us know, some of us, we don't even care about our parents or even look to honor them or respect them. That's not the right way. Now he said, are you mad at me? Are you not pleased with me? He said, wallahi, rather I'm pleased with you. He said, what do you advise me? He said, ma li ala ahadin shay. I don't have any dain, I don't have any debt. He said, what do you advise me? He said, here, he's dying. This is his son. He says, usika bi taqwallahi wal muhafadha ala ta'atihi. He said, I advise you to fear Allah and to maintain his obedience. And to maintain his obedience. Yani. So it's mentioned that this is his way like this. And then some people came to him to give him salam and to visit him. And then they started talking amongst themselves. They came to him to give him salam and to visit him. They started talking amongst themselves. So I said, ish hadha? Uthkur Allah. He said, what is this you guys talking about? This? Remember Allah Azza wa Jal. Mention the name of Allah Azza wa Jal. Don't just talk about this worldly life like this. Like even on his deathbed, he is commanding them to remember Allah. He's like, "Qulu la ilaha illallah." He says, "Say la ilaha illallah. Say something beneficial. Don't waste your time talking about these affairs that you're talking about, especially in this situation." He says, "Nam." So he said, "So we stood up, and everybody started mentioning Allah Azza wa Jal." Nam. And then he says, he also started mentioning the name of Allah Azza wa Jal with his tongue. Nam. And so, and he would point with his eyes. Rahimahullah ta'ala. فَقُمْتُ لِأُنَاوِلَ رَجُلًا كِتَابًا مِنْ جَانِبِ الْمَسْجِدِ. His son said, I stood up to hand somebody a book from the masjid, and I came back and his soul was gone. I came back and his soul was gone. Rahimahullah ta'ala. And he died on the Yawm al-Ithnain, al-Thalith wal-Ishreen, min Rabi'in al-Awwal, sana sitmiya, in the year 600. Rahimahullah ta'ala. And he was a person like this, that he lived his life from the beginning to the end in the obedience of Allah Azza wa Jal, commanding the good and forbidding the evil, and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the way until he was given success at the time of death. And to remember the name of Allah Azza wa Jal and the likes. This is a great scholar of hadith and scholar from the Ummah of Islam. And we have a great example in our ulama. And we follow them. And we take them as our role models. And we want to be like them. And this is a person who spent his whole life defending the sunnah and taking, experiencing hardship for the sake of the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, striving to spread the sunnah of the Prophet and striving to be upon piety, aiding his family and aiding the Muslims, aiding the weak and the poor, so on and so forth, all the way until he died. Even on his deathbed, he is commanding the good. He's commanding the good and commanding the people to not waste their time with speech that is not beneficial. Commanding them to say, La ilaha illallah, all the way until he dies in this manner. Rahimahullah ta'ala. This is the example of a believer. From the great examples of a Muslim is that they will follow these people. That they will follow these people of piety and righteousness. And they will take them as their role models. And they will follow their way. So we begin, inshallah, in the next class, reading from the actual text. The author he has mentioned, or he has entitled, Umdatu الأحكام في معارم الحلال والحرام عن خير الأنام محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام مما اتفق عليه الشيخان البخاري ومسلم. نعم عمدة الأحكام عمدة يعني ما يعتمد عليه. يعني this is the main foundation and fundamentals of the rulings of the halal and the haram from the best of the creation. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with that which has been agreed upon by Bukhari and Muslim. So this is a great opportunity to study and to learn the proper way to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the narrations that are all authentic, whether they're from the greatest of authenticity. The author, he will begin with the book of At-Tahara, and we'll discuss the issues with regards to Tahara, and after that, Istinja, and so on and so forth, and siwak, and the issues with regards to najasa, and how to remove najasa, and with regards to tayammum, and also with regards to al-hayd, and the issues that are related to here, bi-idhni Allahi ta'ala. Hadha wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.